Hello friends, I am Dr. Shivani Jain. I did my post-graduation and senior residency from UCMS. Now I am in private practice and has been teaching students across the country for last 6 years. Today we are going to discuss a very important topic in ophthalmology, which we all find tough to understand. Let's start with the topic retinoscopy. Let's make our concept rock solid hard so that we can solve each and every questions asked in the entrance examinations. So today's topic is retinoscopy. Friends, basically retinoscopy is an objective method of determination of the refractive status of an individual. Okay, so this one is an objective method to determine the refractive status of a patient. Now, there are subjective methods also where the patient judgment plays a role, like fogging, duochrome test, Jackson's cross cylinder, and the pinhole method, where we can refine the objective findings of the retinoscopy. Here, we can give the best correction after our retinoscopic findings are concluded. So, let's start with retinoscopy, guys. Basically, retinoscopy can be done by two types of methods. As you can see here in this picture, this one is known as Priestley-Smith retinoscope. Priestley-Smith retinoscope. So these retinoscopes, they have a plane mirror and they have a concave mirror. So they have one plane mirror and they have a concave mirror. Now these are the reflecting surfaces. They have a small aperture. Here when we hold the retinoscope in one hand and we try to look at the refractive status of the patient, the source of illumination would be behind the left shoulder of the observer. Now we can observe the reflex in the patient's eye through the hole in the instrument. Most commonly we use the plane mirrors, but the use of concave mirror is when we have a hazy media or we expect a very high refractive errors. So these are the conditions where we use the concave part here. High refractive error. Now guys, these instruments are almost obsolete because we have better instruments in the form of a streak retinoscope. So I have it here for you all. This is one is a streak retinoscope. It is a handheld self-illuminating instrument which will project a streak of light, source of illumination. This is going to be inside the patient's eye. Now the light rays from the retina will come to the observer's eye, and now we are going to assess the reflex in the patient's eye. So that's how it is being done here. See this picture. Here the observer is holding the retinoscope in front of one eye, closing the other eye, and we are sitting at a distance of approximately 1 meter. Now, friends, retinoscopy is actually meant to do at a distance of infinity. Why? Because we want parallel rays of light going inside the eye, and we want that in an emmetrope eye, rays of light are to be focused at the retina without any exertion of accommodation. Now this is practically impossible to sit at infinity and doing a retinoscopy, isn't it? That is why we have used a conventional working distance. Now here, most of the time we use a working distance of 1 meter. 1 meter. Now, when we are doing it at 1 meter from the final retinoscopic reading, we will subtract the particular correction, as in when we are doing it at 1 meter, we will subtract from the retinoscopic finding a correction of minus 1 diopters, because we all know that the dioptric power is 1 upon focal length. That is why we are making a correction of 1 diopters. Now friends, most of us are happy doing retinoscopy at a distance of an arm. Now my arm is pretty short, so my working distance would be approximately 2/3 of a meter. Now 2/3 of the meter means that here we have to make a correction of minus 1.5 diopters. Why? because here reciprocal of 2 by 3 is going to be 3 by 2, which means 1.5. So here when we are doing retinoscopy at a distance of 2/3 meter, we have to make a correction of 1.5 diopters. So this is the first thing which we have to consider in mind, that we are using a working distance of 1 meter or 2 by 3 meter, and then we have to make a correction at retinoscopic finding. Now, second important thing is that when we are doing retinoscopy, especially in children and young adults, they exert a lot of accommodation. So when they exert a lot of accommodation, they tend to become myope, isn't it? They tend to become myope. Now, when they tend to become myope, our retinoscopic findings can be very erroneous. That's why we abolish the ciliary muscle tone. That's why we cut off all the accommodation. And that is why the role of cycloplegics come. So now, when we are doing retinoscopy in children, in young adults, especially, we give cycloplegic agents so that the ciliary muscle tone is abolished, the accommodation is all gone. Now, this is going to manifest all the hypermetrope also. So, this is going to make a patient hypermetrope, and the latent hypermetropia will also be manifested. Now, it is better to make a patient hypermetrope. Why? Because we know what is the amount of tonus given by each cycloplegic agent, and then we are going to subtract the cycloplegic tone action from the retinoscopic reading. That means if we are using atropine for paralysis of ciliary muscles, we would be subtracting 1 diopters from the retinoscopic finding. Now, second, we can also use hometropine, for which we have to make a correction factor of approximately 0.5 diopters. Now, we can also use cyclopentolate, for which the correction factor has to be from 0.5 diopters to 0.75. Most commonly, we use 0.75 diopters. Now, we have one more agent in the form of tropicamide. Now, please understand, friends, tropicamide is a very short acting and it's a very weak cycloplegic agent. That is why we have nothing to get subtracted when we use tropicamide. So, it's better not to use tropicamide. Now, guys, apart from the subtraction value, which has to be made at the end of the retinoscopic finding, we should know what is the duration of action of each of the agent. So let's complete the list by writing down the following the duration of hours of each of them. So atropine is a very strong agent. It's a very strong agent and it is also very long acting. So these cycloplegics are mydriatics also, isn't it? They are going to dilate the pupil as well. So the mydriatic action of atropine would last for approximately 2 to 3 weeks, which is pretty long. Now, the cycloplegic action would last for approximately 10 to 14 days, which is also pretty long. Now, the action of hometropine would last for approximately 2 to 3 days. Now, cyclopentolate, though it's a medium level cycloplegic agent, the action lasts for approximately 24 hours. And something about tropicamide, hardly anything to be subtracted here, but the action lasts for approximately 4 to 6 hours. Now, the next step here after doing a cycloplegia in a patient where we want to do a retinoscopy, we will observe the reflex in the patient's eye. So something like this will appear when we show a self-illuminating retinoscope light in the patient's eye. The reflection in the pupillary area would be something like this. Now we have to study this reflex. So this reflex has to be studied. Now friends, this reflex could be a thin reflex. when we move our retinoscope, we have to study the movement of the reflection in the patient's eye also. So this reflex could move very slowly and it could be a dull reflex. Now when you have these three things, TDS, when you have these three things, that means you have a high refractive error. So this suggests that you have a high refractive error. Now in contrast, when you have a thick slit, a thick illumination, that means your light is completely filling your pupillary area, that means you have a thick reflex, or your reflex is moving fast and your reflex is pretty bright. This suggests that your refractive error is very low, or you are about to reach the point of neutralization. So the reflex would be studded. Now guys, we are going to move the retinoscope in directions like this. Now, I would be studying the reflex in the patient's eye by closing my one eye and doing retinoscopy an arm's distance, and I will be looking, observing the reflex in the patient's eye, moving my retinoscope in a horizontal meridian. Now, there can be three possibilities. When I'm moving my retinoscope in this direction, the reflection in patient's eye is also moving in the same direction. We call it with the movement. Okay, this is first possibility. Now, second is against the movement. That means when I'm moving my retinoscope in this direction, the reflection in the patient's eye is moving in the opposite direction. So, this is against the movement. Now, the third possibility could be that when I'm moving my retinoscope in either direction, there is no movement in the patient's eye. So, this is the third possibility. So, let us find out what will be the inference of these three of them. So, the first possibility, the first finding can be with the movement. With the movement means that when I am moving my retinoscope in this direction, the patient's reflection is also moving in the same direction. Now, this suggests that the patient is either a emmetrope or he is a hypermetrope. Or sometimes he may have a small myopia which measures less than one diopter. Okay, so this is a very important question. What is with the movement suggest? Now the second possibility, as we discussed, was against the movement. Against the movement. So this means that when I'm moving my retinoscope in one particular direction, the reflection in the patient's eye is moving in the opposite direction. Now this only has one conclusion, that the patient has a myopia of more than minus one diopters, and this is again a very important question. Now the third possibility is no movement at all. This suggests that the patient has a myopia of one diopters, minus one diopter. So this is again one important question. Now friends, after we study the reflex, we have to neutralize any movement in the patient's eye. So retinoscopy is basically based on principle of neutralization of the reflex. Now let us start with the first thing. If I'm moving my retinoscope here and the patient's reflection is also moving in the same direction, this suggests mostly that patient is a hypermetrope. Now I would be neutralizing the movement. So I would be putting from my trial frame a lens which is of value plus, and I'll be putting in the trial frame, as you see in this picture, this is the trial frame here, and we have various measurements, markings here for the cylinders. We have slots for putting spheres as well. So I'll be putting a plus power of a lens, a plus sphere lens in the patient's in the trial frame in front of the eye. Now if I start putting plus one and now I'm observing the movement, probably it has slowed down. Probably it has slowed down and there is little movement of the reflex. That means there is some movement still. Now I will start putting increasing power of the spherical lens. So now I will put a plus two. Now when I put plus two, if it has been neutralized, there will be no movement of the reflex in the patient's eye. Or if I have overcorrected, there will be opposite movement. So let us take one example where the reflex in the patient's eye has been neutralized. by plus 2 on the horizontal meridian. On the horizontal meridian. So I am doing this and the reflex has been neutralized by putting a plus 2 sphere. Okay. Now, this is about the horizontal meridian. What about the vertical meridian? So, I would also do a checkup in the vertical meridian. Okay. Now, if considering that patient only has a spherical power, so there will be neutralization of the vertical meridian by same power of the lens, which is plus 2. Let's say this is the first question where this is the power cross, which is neutralized by plus 2 sphere. And we are doing a retinoscopy at a distance of 1 meter. And we have used atropine for cycloplegia. Okay. So, this is one question which are commonly asked in your examinations. They give you a power cross. They say that retinoscopy is done at a distance of blah, blah, blah meter. And we have used 1 cycloplegic. Now, what should be the prescription of the glass for this particular patient? Now guys, please do not get confused. This is only the power cross. This is only the retinoscopic finding. This is not the refractive error of the patient. Now we have to conclude what is the refractive power of the patient. For this, we have to make some deductions. Now the deductions from this retinoscopic power cross would be plus 2 here. Now we are going to deduct. We are going to make corrections for the distance. So, this would be minus 1 here, and for atropine, this would again be minus 1, giving a new retinoscopic power of 0 and 0 here, isn't it? Minus plus 2, minus 1 is 0. Here again, we have a 0. So, this gives a value of 0 diopters. That means the patient here is emetrope. So that's why I told you when we moving retinoscope and we observe the movement of the lens in the same direction, the patient could be emetrope also. So that is how we solve very simple questions. Now let's take one more example, the second example here, where the retinoscopic is done at a distance of 1 meter and we have again used atropine. And the retinoscopic value here is plus 4 and plus 4. So, what will be the refractive error of this patient? Let us try to solve it. So, from plus 4 and plus 4 on the vertical and horizontal meridian, we would be subtracting 1 for the distance. We would again be subtracting 1 for the cycloplegia. So, this comes to be about plus 2 and plus 2. So, this simplifies and it is giving us the information that the refractive error would be a hypermetropia and the correction would be given by a plus 2 sphere. So, this is going to take care of all the meridians, horizontal and vertical both. So, this is how we find out. Now, let's take an example where we have the opposite movement of the reflex and the reflex is neutralized by a minus 3 and minus 3 on both the sides. Okay. So, here again, let us take that retinoscopy is done at a distance of 1 meter and here we have used atropine. So, what would be the final retinoscopic value? So, guys, please do not do an algebraic correction. You have to do a subtraction here. So, it is minus 3, minus 1 and minus 1, which gives a value of minus 5. Okay, so the correction, final correction would be minus 5 diopter sphere. So, this patient has a high myopia. Now, let's take another example where we have a patient who has astigmatism. That means the power cross has a different value of neutralization on both meridians. So, let's say the vertical meridian is neutralized by plus 4 diopters and the horizontal meridian is neutralized by putting a 5 diopter lens. Now this, let us solve this question. Here again, retinoscopy is done at a distance of 1 meter and we have used atropine. So after making the correction, we would be having here plus 2. And here we would be having plus 3. So, let us try to solve this question. Now, first, I would like to give the patient a plus 2 diopter sphere. Okay. So, this plus 2 is going to take a whole correction of the things in the vertical meridian. Now, this plus 2 is also going to cover something from the horizontal meridian. So, plus 2 would be taken care of by putting a cylinder on the horizontal meridian also. Now, what is left? What is remaining in the horizontal meridian? It is plus 1. So, plus 1 is still remaining. Plus 1 is what we want more to be added for horizontal meridian. Now, this plus 1 could be given in the form of a cylinder. Okay. So, this plus 1 we would be giving in the form of a cylinder. Now, friends, we all know that cylinder acts perpendicular to where they are placed. This means they act only in one meridian. Okay. Now, if I want here in this question that my cylinder is to act on a horizontal meridian, that is, I want an action on 180 degree. So, I would like to place a cylinder at 90 degree. So, my correction would be plus 2 diopter sphere plus 1 diopter cylinder at 90 degrees. So, this suggests that I have placed a cylinder at 90 degree, which will take care of plus 1 at 180 degrees. Okay. Now, let's solve one more example. Here, the power cross says that it is plus 4 and it is plus 2 in the horizontal meridian. So, retinoscopy is done at 1 meter and we have used Hometropine as a cycloplegic agent. Now, let's see how to subtract this. So, from plus 4, it would be plus 3 after correction of the retinoscopic working distance. And for hometropine, we have to subtract 0.5. So, here it would be plus 4 minus 1 and minus 0.5. Plus 4 minus 1 and 0.5. So, this would give rise to a power of plus 2.5. Here again, we have plus this would be 0.5. This would be 0.5 here. So, how are we going to prescribe glasses for this patient? Let us see. So, we can take 0.5 cylinder here, which is going to correct everything on the horizontal medium. Now, it is going to correct 0.5 from this value also. So, what would be remaining here on the vertical meridian? It would be 2 diopters which is remaining on the vertical median. So, this 2 diopters would be given in the form of a cylinder at 180 degrees. Because we want cylinder to act at 90 degree, that's why we are giving the cylinder at 180 degree. Okay. So, this is how we can do retinoscopic corrections and we can conclude what the refractive error in the patient is. Now, friends, there is another method of giving prescription to the patient, which is called as transposition. We are transposing the values here in a cylindrical correction so as to better suit the patient. Okay. Sometimes these transposed values better suit the patient. And this is nothing but a prescription equivalent of one type of retinoscopic and refractive finding. So, the step number one in transposing is that we have to algebraically add the diopter and the cylinder. So, you algebraically add sphere and cylinder value. Now, second is to change the sign of the cylinder. Second is you change the sign of a cylinder. And third is you change the axis of the cylinder by 90 degrees. Okay. So, let's see if we can transpose this particular finding. So, first is we would be algebraically adding it. So, this would be 2 plus 2.5 diopter cylinder. Now, we have to change the sign of the cylinder. So, this would be minus 2 diopter cylinder. And next is we have to change the axis. So, this would become plus 90 degrees. So probably this kind of transposing value suits the patient better. Okay, so this is how we can make transpositions. Now, another thing is we can give a spherical equivalent to the patient. We can give a spherical equivalent to the patient. Now, guys, this spherical equivalent is nothing but the algebraic addition. This is a new sphere which would come by making an addition of sphere and half the value of the cylinder. Like here in this case, we have to add a plus 2.5 cylinder with a half of the cylindrical value. So this comes out to be just 1.5 diopter sphere. So you can try giving a spherical equivalent to this patient. Probably this will also have a same effect as that of this value. Okay. So I hope you have learned retinoscopy well and you have got your concepts built here. Now you will be able to solve all the problems related to it. So the next part would be how to refine our retinoscopic findings by doing a subjective refraction. That would be covered in the next video. Thank you.